fucking deserve. Bang.
He was not gay. Oh no.
Meet Pont, my second mage in my little side project for the past few weeks. Look at how sad she is.
Oh, it's no. Because she doesn't have Mage Blade.
I'd sit on this tune getting boosted through dungeons by my absolutely new chad of a guild who actually love and respect me. After taking about 2 weeks to get to level 40, I decided to go fucking sicko mode on them.
Okay,
and
good.
Use my full power. Mage be nimble, mage be quick, mage level fast, and suck your dick. I started off in Zolfarak doing a newfound zombie farm and was getting about 140,000 XP per hour.
No,
this isn't cheating, this is completely fine, what are you talking about? Whilst my friend was leveling like a normal fucking person, getting about 25,000 per hour.
What a loser.
Fucking casual, ugh.
Yeah, fuck him, dude.
Wait, why am I sheeped? Hello? What? Hi! Oh my god!
In only about 10 hours of gameplay, I had gone from level 40 to level 55. But oh shit! My guild's doing a molten core, and I'm level 55.
Why not?
So I need to get attuned and put this puppy into full gear.
Yeah.
So with the help of a demigod warlock who is unfazed by solid matter, I managed to get my molten core attunement just in the nick of time. Phased by solid matter. Yeah. So
what?
With the help of a demigod warlock
who
is unfazed by solid matter, I managed to get my molten core achievement just in the nick of time.
That's
now
easy.
In this molten core, my guild actually let me roll on
Got
loot
it.
Under the pretense that I would hit 60 within the next week.
Yeah, okay.
I received a mediocre belt, a comfortable
nice.
Pair of mittens,
That's
and
cute.
One of the best, most sought after rings a mage can get in the whole game.
Wow.
And I couldn't even equip any of it. Yeah, I'm definitely
like.
In the right guild. From there, I made my way to Zul Guru, where I opted to beat my head against a brick wall for fucking hours on end, because I'm too stubborn, I will get this eventually, FUCK! Until my skill prevailed, and I was getting about 300,000 XP per hour, which is quite literally the fastest leveling method in the entire game, bringing me from level 58 to 60 in about 90 minutes. If my last video didn't convince you to play mage, these fucking leveling speeds should. Now I could finally equip my epic items.
So... That's insane! That's absolutely fucking insane, man! How is it that OP? Holy fuck!
Wow! I look the exact fucking same!
Wow.
Unfortunately, I couldn't make it to raid the next week, so one of my friends gave me some extremely wise advice.
Okay, what did they say?
Pint, you should start a GDKP. Also, you are cool. Now, if you don't know what a GDKP is, essentially everyone bids on items for gold, and then all of that gold is divided amongst all the raid members at the end of the raid.
Not really, though, because then you have to pay into the pot, and then after the pot, you have to get consumables for the main people that come next week. So that means that you actually split the pot 42 ways. And then so if you have 40,000 gold, that actually goes to like 950 gold. But then somehow whenever all the trades go out, just to make it easier to trade people, it actually somehow goes down to 900. So whenever you do the math a number of times, and then you also divide out the extra cuts that are going in towards the pot, it turns out that people don't actually get the amount of gold that they were supposed to get, but actually about only 85% of that. And then you shave off the top an extra, I don't know, 3 to 4 shares? I don't know who would do that. I really don't. And then also if people leave, you take their cuts too. Because you're dividing it among 25, even though there's not 25 people. Sorry, 40 people there. I don't know why I said 25.
Now, seeing as I'm playing on an American server, I figured I'd embrace the culture a little bit and indulge in one of the country's oldest traditions.
Using a gun.
Violent capitalism. So I got some of my friends together and I made a nifty little Discord and I started spamming trade chat more than any of my competitors like the anime villain I am. Anytime a mage would whisper me, I'd go to their Warcraft logs and check if they needed any of the gear that I needed.
Good.
And if they did, well...
Don't invite them.
We'd be conveniently full on mages.
Yep. How convenient that is.
And somehow, by the time Raid came around, we had multiple Thunder Fury wielders, a Scarab Lord, and a High Warlord all in the raid ready to go.
What a bunch of losers!
After a home run from Gar and a Shazra Shinobi, morale was still looking high and some pretty swanky items had
dropped.
Damn,
that's actually really good.
We defeated Ragnaros the Fire Lord, and it was time to let the vultures feast. I got a nice pair of Yeezys for pretty cheap. I got some sweet new gloves to finish up my 3-set, and won the tier 2 pants at a hearty 75 gold.
Jesus.
After the rogues had finished bidding on their
second-hand
Ego Bloodfang pants,
you are not a chat.
Oh, damn.
We decided it was time to start auctioning the most coveted of items.
My
feet picks! Woo! Hold on. You just looked at my feet. Wait, do you feel that? It's the cold, unblinking eyes of your ISP, hackers,
and the Queen of England.
But worry not, my dear viewer, because with ExpressVPN, you can keep all of your activity hidden and encrypted, so that neither Her Majesty nor anyone else can see what you're doing online. Now you can watch all of those Felix makeup tutorials you've been wanting to watch without anyone knowing.
See, I thought it was gonna...
Your secret's safe with me.
But that's not all. I know you have plenty of time to catch up on all those Netflix shows while you wait for Blizzard to fix Shadowlands PvP.
I have been
What's
got
that?
There. I did
the
not
hit
expect
new show
that
is region locked and you can't watch it? Well,
wow.
With ExpressVPN, you can change your location with just one click and watch any show from any...
Is this basically just NordVPN, but it's a different name?
Where I'm in the world. Look at how easy
I'm not sure.
Even a mage could do it. Let's see, what do you guys like?
Yes, All right, I thought so.
So I decided to watch the critically
Lord
acclaimed
VPN.
Anime Japan anime movie, Mary and the Witch's Flower, which is only available in the US. But with ExpressVPN, I was able to change my location and watch the whole thing without a problem.
How
and
about
you know,
that?
I gotta say,
that's
I
crazy.
Quite liked it. Wait a minute. This is copyright infringement. Expect to be hearing from my lawyer. Find out how you can get 3 months free by clicking the link in the description box below at expressvpn.com/pint. Back to the video.
So you can use this to, you can install this VPN and then use it to look at porn at school? That's awesome. Holy shit, that's awesome, man.
Thanks to my Asmongolding, which is, yes, now a verb, I have been...
No, it's not. No, it's not. Oh, thank God it's not. I was so worried that it was. Oh my God, I was so fucking... I was so terrified. Holy shit. Like... No, because, like, you never know whenever they're going to put something like that into the dictionary. Like, I got to be careful, guys.
Receiving hefty stimulus packages from simps and e-girls alike.
Yep.
And this allowed me to purchase the Talisman of Ephemeral Power for only 700 gold.
Very smart guy.
I could have spent on at least 1,400 Night Elf lap dances.
Oh, my God. That's a lot.
Maybe it was a waste of money.
That is a lot.
Yeah, just song Mage Blade. I laid down hard with a fat 100.
100G.
I know none of these other motherfuckers need this shit.
That's right.
I made sure of it. And that's how I got my Azhasong. Wait, no! What the fuck, dude? You're a warrior!
What?
I know what this is. This guy's trying to bid me up so I end up paying more gold.
Wait,
but
what?
I can't afford this, man.
A warrior?
I give
up.
Wait,
why?
Wait. Oh. Oh.
400?
Don't
wait.
Say anything.
What?
I won't. Oh, whoa.
Oh my
Maybe
God.
Socialism has its merits.
400G? And he got it. Oh, that's cute. That's real cute. Don't do it, Arthas.
As the righteous, upstanding, obviously good guy Alliance Gnome that I once was.
Uh-huh.
I must admit, the dark side had clearly wormed its way into my heart.
Absolutely.
No longer was I the small gnome you've all come to know and love.
Now what?
Now I had become
a fucking
a big, fat, stinky zug. And since Horde
it's
are clearly
good.
The bad guys in World of Warcraft, it was time.
They are, thank you. Like, it's obvious that they're the bad guys. Like, Horde are always the aggressors. like Horde bombed Theramore, Horde burned down Teldrassil. Like every terrorist attack is being committed by the Horde. Now think about that. They always are wrong. They always are doing bad shit. The Horde are the aggressors. And that it was a preemptive strike. Yeah, it was a pussy ass fucking bunch of bullshit, okay? Arthas was a terrorist. Arthas was mind controlled, okay? Like, yeah, right. He was fucking mind controlled by the Lich King. It's not gonna happen. Stormheim? Who gives a shit about that? Horde are the bad guys in the story. Everybody knows it. You know it, I know it, everybody knows it.
For me to claim my vengeance.
Yep.
Nay, justice.
No, dude!
I think it's Serenity would be my perfect target. So
wait.
What dastardly plan could I conjure?
He's gonna go back and kill
simple,
his own
really?
Guild?
Hit him with the oldest trick in the book.
Oh, no.
Goblin sapper charge and some AoE damage from a few mages can wipe an entire raid in seconds.
Oh, no.
So I had a team to assemble. First of all, set up a shadow Discord and get all of your mage friends in there. Set up
okay.
a certain time and place to meet.
Spoons
get an
six.
Alliance tune to kill us in a very specific spot so that our bodies are hidden, but we can still res right where Serenity would be.
Oh
but let's
God.
Not forget the most important piece of the puzzle.
Oh my God.
My good friend Bradshaw. Bradshaw still raided with Serenity and thus would be my man
Wait.
On the inside.
Wait, so he sold out his own guild? Wait, and this guild gave him the fucking belt? Bro, this dude got the fucking belt and he's selling out his own guild. That's a warrior? Listen, warriors don't do this. This guy's a bitch. Well, I guess there's something wrong with him. You can tell there's obviously something wrong with this guy because he's wearing ranking gear, okay? So it's not really his fault.
He would tell me what layer they were on because back then layers were still
oh
a thing, but you know, they've since removed them, but you
and
know, they were
gone.
They were back then, it's old footage. So then
yeah.
I came and half the mages on the roster didn't fucking show up, but that's okay.
It's too bad.
Because we were all there at the gates of AQ.
Okay.
Ready to, dunk on them hoes.
Holy oh no.
We see them on the horizon and suddenly all of my hardships, my pain, my suffering.
Is this his own character that
finally,
he re-leveled on the Horde?
A shot at redemption.
Oh my
a
God.
A shot at justice.
Killing his own guild.
So yeah, we only killed like three people, but one of those people was Kitiara, who was usually Serenity's top pumpin' warrior. But he died on the first boss, so the fact that I killed him doesn't
Man.
Matter.
So Wait, he died on the first boss. Oh. Okay.
The next day, I finished up a GDKP, and I'm going to turn in my items when
uh-huh.
I see Serenity is summoning people on the roof to
oh,
get their
no.
ZG buff.
Oh no.
Well, I still have a couple sappers in my inventory.
Oh,
what if
God.
I just. After getting my ass promptly beat, my guild talks about needing some backup
yeah,
at the
know,
gates of AQ
perfect,
while
right?
they summon. I figured Serenity's
okay.
raid time would be soon, so I head over to help out. My guild zoned into AQ, and shortly after,
off,
Serenity
right?
arrived at the gates, which
Serenity
I proudly
here.
Defended to my extremely dying breath. No.
I love how everybody in the entire guild that he's in is all just like waiting to kill him. Wait. That Kitiara guy? This is the top warrior in your guild? No wonder your guild sucks. He's using Quel'Thuzar. This guy's trash. This guy's terrible. Look at him. He's using Quel'Thuzar. What a fucking idiot.
Not gonna lie, boys, felt kinda
oh
humiliated
God.
At this point. Despite my later run-ins with Serenity being
what
pretty coincidental, I presume they took it as an act of further aggression.
Yeah, they bet
So I decided
I
to embrace my meme even further. All shall kneel beneath my foot. Witness me!
Oh,
Oh.
They kicked me. I don't blame them, man.
So they kicked me from the guild Discord.
Yeah, you live like a bitch,
know,
you die like
Maybe
a bitch.
Maybe it wasn't worth it.
Yeah.
Leveling a whole other character. Crying about not getting given. Fuck. Nah. Fuck that. This is the only fun I can have in this fucking game anymore. Creating my own roleplay PvP
oh
experience
God.
Is really fun. I'd recommend it.
Whether your character is Orkman McZuggyzug, who terrorizes the lobbies of Duskwood, or Sir Chad, the guy that PvPs without a chestplate and flexes after every kill.
It's good, I like that.
Making a name for yourself with a fun PvP gimmick and a bit of a story is, in my opinion, one of the most fun things you can do in Classic. Because in the end, the only thing better than killing strangers online is killing your friends. I don't hate Serenity, I just want bloodshed. You think my...
I always kind of wanted to do that, is like level up a whole new character and then kill my own guild. But then I got to level 2 and I got bored. I was like, this is taking too long. Like, oh my god, like, I don't want to do this. So I just gave up.
My conquest would be so easily thwarted by feelings.
Uh-huh.
My friend, if I was going to give up so easily, I'd have already done it by now.
So
this was only
now?
The beginning.
Are you kidding me?
Soon I would begin my training with some of the most distinguished PvPers on the server.
Oh, God.
Such as Wukul. Slowly, my power grew, and I gained some mad clout in the White Mane PvP community.
Amazing.
I would make my faction proud.
This guy didn't start
ranking,
did he?
I'd already killed a few at the gates of AQ.
Oh my god.
So all I had to do was hunt down the rest of them and drive them into the ground like the dogs
they are.
He's
killing his own guild.
Loktar. Oh, wait. I mean, for the Alliance.
This is... Yeah.
Kill number one. Kitiara. Again, because he was online, so... I head over to Booty Bay.
I mean, the guy sucks, to be fair. Like, let's be honest. Like, he's using Quel'Thalar. Like, holy shit.
Mage pal to pump some frostbolts into him.
Oh,
he popped
come
shield
on,
wall, but
dude.
Unfortunately, that's not enough to save him from the fact that warriors, upon entering combat with a mage, are clinically diagnosed with a...
Fuck you. Fuck you. Actually... It's not me. That's not me.
Erectile dysfunction, swiftly followed by deleting your character and turning you gay.
It's not me.
I even managed to get a few bites in before we made our great escape.
Oh
I'm
God.
Passing BM right now, my dude. Kill number 2 and Zalia. I track him down
God.
To Eastern Plaguelands and I start hunting. I find him and clap his human female cheeks
Jesus
several times.
Christ.
We have an epic chase scene which ends in him unfortunately dead yet again, followed by him taking
wow.
res sickness and porting.
What a surprise.
I decide to call it a night and I snuggle into bed feeling
yeah.
great about myself.
Isn't that cute?
And sleep without an ounce of remorse.
Yeah.
I log on the next day and who do I find?
Is it the
Anzella.
Warrior?
Oh, but he's AFK. I couldn't kill him.
Oh, look what look what he has on him, dude. Look, he's got the fucking sword. Oh, it's fucking amazing.
Adam being
yeah,
here,
he's
I'll
got
just
the fucking sword.
Lower his health so that when he comes back, he
That's
can see my
part.
Face before he eats the dirt. Feels pretty
oh
good to
God.
Camp someone who has better gear than you. But
yeah.
eventually I got bored and moved on when I was told by Branchill
okay.
that Anzella didn't know who I was and also didn't really speak English, so he couldn't understand my incessant shit-talking. Now, I already knew this was going to take a while.
You didn't even know what the fuck's
so
going on.
So I back to my training and remembered.
Just some random ass dipshit.
Technique passed down
yeah,
through
didn't
generations.
Even care.
Young Punt, today I teach you the art of having more people on your team. So I began
oh, yeah.
recruiting a valiant
that
set
works
of
really well
to do
in
my
PvP.
Bidding. I would be the Twitch Eagle streamer, and they, my humble chat mods.
Oh boy.
I'd reward them with 10
He's
gold per kill and a shout
now?
Out in my
oh
next
my
video. So now the whole world knows that you guys are fucking cheap clout chasers, Lamau. And of course,
yep.
Serenity saw the bounty that I'd placed on them. Some would say it lacks subtlety, but I'd say it's an alpha gamer move. So,
Wait, so this is like actual drama that happened, and he's paying people to kill his own guild? Holy shit, dude. Holy fucking shit. See, I told you guys I should have played on a PvE server, man. Like, this is so fucking ridiculous. This is what Classic Andes do. See, they run out of game content. There's nothing else going on in the game. And so this is what they have to do instead. They invent these problems and these issues they have with each other, man. This is crazy. This is nuts.
Late night in Hinterlands,
Absolutely
my first
nuts.
Pupil, Chilbra, head out to scoop
okay.
up a couple kills on Shinarino, and he even cannibalized after. God, he makes me so proud.
Okay.
But he didn't get the kill on the Thunder Fury tank, so I'm gonna have to bump him down to an A-. Still, that's two kills. Also, he killed Laser Chicken, but I don't know who that is. So next up, Melandra. After getting a sloppily screenshotted kill on Angelzor,
that's nice.
She did manage to get a tasteful one shot on Marty McFarty. And finally,
oh no, it was at the Dark Moon Fair too. That guy was trying to get buffs.
Managed to get a tasteful.
Look out! He's just trying to get buffs, man. Dude, he's just trying to get buffs. What the hell?
One shot on Marty McFarty.
What an asshole.
And finally, Viscount. My right-hand man and my tier 3 sub. This guy leveled a Horde Tune just to help kill Serenity.
Good.
He camped Silithus all day and night. And this guy had more kills in Serenity than me.
Wow.
Dude, he's dangerous.
Yeah.
So I head over to Silithus to help him camp one night. And
okay.
I see Tilo. This guy.
All right.
This guy who laughed at me. We hit him with some pyroblasts until eventually
good.
He flies out of town, never
yeah,
to be seen
him.
Again. Until Viscount pulls a 400 IQ move of predicting that he was going to Tanaris. We land in Gadgetzan and see who other than T-Lol, who of course runs to the inn to use his hidden technique of logging off and shit-talking in Discord once again.
Oh,
we waited
no.
in the inn for him to log back on for a whole 50 minutes before we decided to pack an inn for the night.
Bro, this is some stalker shit, man. What the fuck? Oh my god, 50 minutes? You're sitting there? Oh, I can't wait for him to come back. Whenever he come back, we go to get him. I know it. Dude, I've had people back at the beginning of Classic, dude. I had people that waited for like 3 hours just for me to zone out of a raid so they could auto attack me once and hopefully get their name read on screen. Like, this is nuts, man. These people are fucking nuts. Fucking neckbeards. These are beyond neckbeards. These are like wizards. That's what it is. They're like fucking, these are super wizards, like mega wizards, because they're beyond neckbeards. And this is all they do, is they just play, like, their whole life and everything is just about this. It's crazy. Archmages, yeah, probably almost, yeah, Archmages, that'd be good.
And unfortunately, this was the beginning of a pattern with Serenity.
Okay.
The next day, I tracked down another member to Blackrock Depths, and I waited outside for 40 minutes, but he never came out. Even Melandra, in hopes to get some extra credit, and some boys from the guild, camped the portal room to catch Serenity as they ported in. And while we spilt plenty of Alliance blood, none of it was Serenity. I even took my massacre to Ironforge.
Oh my god.
Still, no Serenity. Every day, the amount of people online in Serenity dwindled. I knew my time was limited. And in my desperation, I put up all the money that I had left.
Wait.
1,000 gold to anyone who wiped Serenity. Chilbra and Viscount decided to plan the final assault.
He was breaking the entire guild by doing this so much? Holy shit. This guy destroyed a guild? Oh my god. So he deletes his own guild because they didn't give him the sword. Should have played on a PvE server, man. That's all it comes down to. Should have played on a PvE server. All I've got to say. Holy fucking shit. Wow.
Gathered a much larger kill squad than last time.
Oh my god.
Completely ready to kill Serenity once and for all to claim the 1,000
gold bounty. That actually is kind of a
gold bounty. But there they were outside of AQ.
Okay. But nobody came. I know what that's like. Oh,
it's been 3 weeks since Serenity has not been seen raiding.
What?
The raid leader left the guild amongst some others. Was it unrelated? Does having an angry LARPing gnome biting at your guild's ankles cause some damage over time, or am I giving myself too much credit? Who knows?
This probably had nothing to do with that, to be fair. Probably was like, you think about a guild that, like, it's like, there's like numerous e-girl drama sagas that are leaking the loot council stuff. Let's be honest, one mage is the least of their problems. Like, this guild was fucked from the very beginning. Like, let's be honest.
So.
Wait, it's gonna be shit. Yeah, I mean, this is a. It seems like a fucked up guild.
The past few weeks have been some of the most fun I've had in Classic. The role playing, the companionship, the enemies. Serenity may have died, but not in the way I'd hoped. When the ranking system and the raid buff culture offered no entertainment, Serenity was there to keep me playing. To give me a reason to log on, a reason to go out in the world. But here I stand, with everything I ever wanted, and yet, at what cost?
Oh shit.
I have Mageblade, and although my slaughter was shorter than I'd hoped, here I am, missing Serenity.
Fuck.
Because after all, what is the hunter without the hunt?
What? No!
It's me, Pint, from Dancing. Now,
no!
Most of you people aren't subscribed, so if you like this content, please do it. Also, Patreon, previews, tutorials, blah, 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 blah. And I'm probably gonna stream, so follow my Twitch, please. Anyways, I'd like to thank all of Serenity, and especially Marvy the GM, for being a good sport throughout this whole thing.
Yeah, sure.
I'd also like to thank Sweppy for some of the art you've seen in this video.
That
Twitter.
It's really meaningful.
Also, my hard drive failed, and I moved out of my parents' house, and my life's falling apart. Bye.
You moved out of your parents' house? That's a mistake. That's a fucking mistake. He should not have done that at all. So there's the video. This guy makes great videos. He deserves our support. I would, you know what? I will unsubscribe from him just so I can subscribe again. Okay? This guy's great. We'll give him a like on his video. Make sure to give him some support. These are the kinds of videos that you remember after a year. Like, these are the videos, for example, like, you will remember this video probably way longer than, you know, Bill's update on Shadowlands. You know what I mean? Like, these are the videos that are timeless, that tell a story, and I think we should promote that, and we should,
What's up, guys? It's your boy Dan Boy, back with another video. Today we are gonna have a look at AQ40 and how you can optimize your DPS and get higher parses. In this guide, we will be having all will buffs. Of course, getting Dark Moon Fair as well helps you greatly in achieving higher parses. The more buffs, the better. If you have any questions or the like, feel free to throw me a comment down below. A sub and a like would be greatly appreciated. I do also stream on Twitch Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 7 to 11 p.m. plus 2 GMT. Come hang out with me, ask me some questions. I'm always open to chat. I do also have a Discord you can join if I'm not live streaming. Come and hang, it's a great community. Anyway, let's get started. Before we have a look at the bosses, I just have two quick tips. I recommend you use Blessed Sunfruit when you're in your AQ run. If your guild is fast at clearing, Blessed Sunfruit gives you only 10 strength, but you just have to click it one and it instantly applies the food buff. The second thing is always be ready on your mount when you're about to go on a boss. Personally, in this run, I tend to forget that, and it gives me less uptime on the boss. So just two great tips to begin with, and then we'll have a look at the bosses now. For every boss, you want to strive to have max rage before you engage the boss. This way you'll get off from a good start and you can pump straight away. Anyway, on Scarum, you want to use Badge on the first attack, and then you want to use Deathwish. You can actually use them together because it's only Deathwish that has a global cooldown. And then when you reach 6 Badge stacks or you have 21 seconds left on Deathwish, you want to pop your Earthstrike. And then you want to use your Mighty Rage. Preferably use a Mighty Rage when you have no rage, of course. But you want to use it when you have all the other cooldowns up. And so you get them all at the same time and maximizing your damage. Watch out when you're cleaving or whirlwinding, though. One of your teammates might be MC'd and you will kill him if you have all these buffs. So watch out for that. On Bucktrio, you want to pre-pop your Diamond Flask to not waste a global cooldown when you're on the boss. You want to use Badge on the first attack, and then you want to use Deathwish together with Badge. And then depending on how quick you kill one of the dudes, you want to pop your Mighty Rage so you have it up with all the other cooldowns you just popped. And the three adds are still up. That way you can cleave and pump 100%. As for Recklessness, if you're cleaving, this shouldn't be needed depending on your gear again. But you can pop Recklessness on this boss, 16 seconds left on Deathwish. Or you can do it from the start, but I would be careful of that. You might pull aggro, especially if you are playing Horde. A quick reminder though, cleaving on this is only for parses. When you kill one of them, the other two will heal up to 100%. So it does not benefit your raid if you cleave. On Satura, you want to use Badge from the get-go, first attack, then pop it with Deathwish. Then you want to pop your Earthstrike, and then you want to pop Wreck. And then you want to do your first Whirlwind to cleave down these adds and get those fat parses. When you go on the boss, you want to use your Lip when you go low HP. As you see, I popped it here at 40%. And just be careful, because the Whirlwind does really hurt. You don't want to lose your world buffs in this boss. I actually did it last week because I changed my keybinds and I by mistake popped a FAP instead of a Lip. So shit happens, you know. For the last two bosses, Bucktrio, Satura, and Frankris, I know I am putting on Wreck at every boss, but of course you can only use it one of those bosses. But I feel like on Frankris, unless you're really lucky with your RNG crits, you will need to have Wreck to actually do a 99 on Frankris. Anyways, this is just a tank and spank fight. You're gonna pop Deathwish when 31 seconds left, Earthstrike when 21 seconds left on Deathwish, and you're gonna use your Mighty Rage pot during execute phase when you have no rage, and then Wreck at 16 seconds left. As for Visitus, I have not really tried parsing on this guy, but I would assume using Diamond Flask from the get-go, Deathwish right after, and the Mighty Rage Potion is going to get you some high damage output on this guy. But there's not much to talk about this guy. He doesn't matter on the logs. But I just wanted to mention it, what I would do if you wanted to actually parse on Visitus. And of course, you'd have to use your DPS gear. Here in this fight, I'm of course using Nature's Rest gear to minimize damage, kill the boss faster. As for Uhuruan, we are going to be using Death Riz when 31 seconds left of the boss fight. Airstrike, 21 seconds left on Death Wish. You can use Mighty Rage when you have no rage during execute phase, and you can make a big fat execute with the rage you get from the pot. You can use Recklessness on this boss again, like the last three previous bosses. You decide where you want to use Wreck. I just wanted to point out these are the fights that most people use them on, so you can use it later on. And of course you want to be dispelled as long as you have like 5-6k HP, and it's not during the enrage phase, because you will die if you get dispelled under 30% HP, most likely. The next couple of bosses are a little bit more tricky. On Twin Embers, if you kill slower than 2 minutes and 20 seconds, you can actually use your Mighty Rage plus Earthstrike from the start. If you kill it slower than 3 minutes and 30 seconds, you can use your Death Wish plus Badge as well from the start, together with the two other buffs. So why should you pop them from the start? Well, if you do so, you can actually use them again at the end of the fight. More damage. Simple as that. Whether you kill it faster than 2 minutes and 20 seconds or 3 minutes and 30 seconds, you will still be using your cooldowns in the end at the same time. What I do is I will, when he teleports, I want to go to him early. I want to use my badge and Death Wish together. And then I want to pop my Earthstrike when I have 6 badge stacks or I have 21 seconds left on Death Wish. As for Mighty Rage, you want to use this during execute phase like we've done previously. When you have no rage, so you do it right after a big fat execute that drains all your rage, and then you want to pop the Mighty Rage. As for Uro, you want to, depending on how quick you kill it, if you kill it within 1 minute, you want to pre-pop your Diamond Flask. Otherwise, pop it when there is 61 seconds left off the fight. You want to pop Death Wish when there's 31 seconds left. And as for the knockback slash sweeps, you want to use Intercept on the first sweep if you get knocked. Then on the second one, you want to use a Lip so you don't get knocked back. And on the third one, you want to use Intercept again. As you can see, I was late to the party. I forgot to mount here. So, brain fart from my perspective. But, you know, it happens. I am trying to adapt every week. It's all about practicing. If you're struggling with threat, because you're probably playing Horde, or you have a bad tank on a line side, you can use a FAP instead and go out and eat a Sandblast to reduce your threat. But I have not done this myself, I have not tested it, so be careful, I guess. The reason why I use a FAP is so when you get Sandblasted, you don't get stunned. You can also use a Lip, as far as I know, so pick either one and go out and eat a Sandblast, reduce your threat and pump again. The last boss fight of them all, Cathun, Cthun, however you want to pronounce his name. Of course, you want to mount and run in. Anyways, on this guy, it works the same as Twin Amps. If you kill slower than 2 minutes and 20 seconds, you can use Mighty Rage Pot plus Earthstrike from the start. If you kill it slower than 3 minutes and 30 seconds, you can use Death Wish together with Mighty Rage and Earthstrike from the start. Nonetheless, you're still gonna use your cooldowns at the end, like everybody else. Death Wish, you wanna pop in the last phase when he's vulnerable, when there's 31 seconds left till he's dying. You wanna use your Earthstrike 21 seconds before he's dead. You wanna use your Mighty Rage Pot when you have no rage, you've just used an execute and you want to have lots of rage again for a new one. And you're going to pop your Recklessness when there's 16 seconds left on your Death Wish. As for the rest of the fight, remember to get Sunders on the target before he goes vulnerable. As for doing Whirlwind on him, you need to stack inside die, but not too far in to get knocked. And then you want to keep jumping. And then sometimes your whirlwinds will hit, but it's not a guarantee at all. I don't think I've actually hit one myself yet. But I've been trying, and hopefully one day it'll happen. If you have any questions or the like, feel free to throw me a comment down below. A like and a sub would also be greatly appreciated. It definitely helps my channel. I do stream on Twitch Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 7 to 11 p.m. plus 2 GMT. Come in and hang out with me. If I'm not online on Twitch, you can catch me on Discord.
Hey guys, in this video I wanted to go over my 2-week Mayhem Race character. got him up to level 99. It is a dual wield Sunder Gladiator guy. Very straightforward character, and kind of the reason I'm making this is it right now would be a pretty top tier choice to start off with in 3.0. I mean, it's honestly a very solid character all the way around. Probably can do all content in the game if you scaled it up enough, but general mapping, this is a shape tier 12, pretty much no problem. Double damage mods or two mods that kind of hinder your damage, enfeeble or whatever, extra life, you're really not going to notice too much of a penalty, damage taken, or the amount that you do. So clear speed's decent, not the greatest, but it is just Sunder, so you probably could scale this character up to do all content in the game. Guardian Shaper or whatever, you could go crit if you scaled it up, stuff like that. So overall, pretty happy with this character. There's some things that make Sunder as good as it is. One is dual wielding it, the way it works, and some of the gem choices you can use. So I'll go over all of that. So first, Sunder. We are linked to melee fizz and added fire, and the strongest gem here, Conk Effect. So the way Conk Effect works with Sunder is that the on-death kill explosions from Sunder are what's getting area penalized, not your actual Sunder animation, graphic, whatever. The girth and length of your Sunder is not penalized for using Conk Effect, which is insane. Multi-strike melee fizz as our last two gems, but like I said, Conk Effect, basically you're getting it for free, and it's like the strongest gem in the game for raw damage, 54% more damage at level 20, so probably the biggest reason why Sunder is ridiculous, and paired with the Gladiator Ascendancy is it's going to carry your AoE with the Bleed Explosion. So the way dual wielding works with Sunder is it only swings with your main hand, so offhands, shields, whatever, offhands are stat sticks. So in this case I'm using Tempestuous Steel. You could use Prismatic Eclipse or the Princess, both are really good as well. Princess is like one alchemy orb, and it does basically the same thing this does. Just has a little bit of a damage taken drawback. So the weapon penetration with elemental resistances and hits can't be evaded are local, so they're not affecting your main hand at all. But the physical attack damage added as lightning and fire are being applied to your main hand, so this is a great offhand, probably the best, or Prismatic Eclipse the best, kind of depends. I guess Prismatic Eclipse offers some defense as well. It gives like 8 block and global attack speed, so it's pretty comparable, so whichever, it's good. Don't think I have one lying around here, but so yeah, that's how dual wield works with Sunder basically, and those are your choices. One other thing, for your jewelry, for damage, you're going to want flat on all your jewelry basically. It's going to carry a lot of your DPS, so just like life, flat, two most important, then try to get your resistances. This isn't even a great one-hander that I had. You could use Soul Taker or something, which isn't even that good. I mean, rare one-handed axe is going to be insane. Gloves, attack speed, life, resistances, you know, if you could get flat, that'd be great. So I'm using Belly of the Beast plus Gum's Roots. Gum's Roots is insane, if you didn't know. You can't be stunned, temp chains immune, chilled ground immune, it's pretty ridiculous. So Belly of the Beast plus Gum's Roots gives me a fuck ton of life, as you can see. 8500, and I still have pretty good DPS. I mean, I kind of memed it up by getting some extra life nodes, but Belt of the Deceiver, very, very good belt. So the way it works is enemies are intimidated. I think a lot of players don't understand that it's basically mobs are taking 10% more damage, which, you know, kind of means basically that you're doing 10% more damage. So there's basically no belt a character like this can use that's going to give the damage that Belt of the Deceiver gives. Sorry. You know, like flash charges gain, blah, blah, other nice mods that rare belts can get. You can argue those for sure, but raw damage output, Belt of the Deceiver, it's super cheap, easy to get, and reduced damage from crits is really nice. Helm, just get like some life, resist helm. There's not really a reason to use any unique. Here's my shitty axe. It's like 300, just over 300 DPS. So, flash choices. Lion's Roar, probably the best. I didn't get a Taste of Hate. One that it dropped, couldn't get.
Hey man, this is Pointless Till Blizz Makes PvP Hardcore Servers with No Account Banks. What do you mean by that? I don't follow. Okay. Cooking.
Goodbye, everyone.
That beautiful Mulgore music, man. Tiger meat plus cooking equals rich cargoes. Well, you know what my plan is, dude. I did this on my rogue. I was gonna go to Desolus. Those were the snacks back in the day. Snyder's pretzels. That's another one. It's another throwback. Anybody here eat pretzels with mustard? That's one of the things I really like as well, man.
Got blood rush to my head, they hot lock popping off the fucking block. Now clocking wristlet, watch bent up off. Step up, dragon volume blasting, bailing out my brain. Red light flash.
which meant if you wanted to use it, you had to just do it raw and pray it worked. Many characters had things which could just always avoid him on the way down, such as any teleport, Moshor Yukins, or Vega's own backflip. The super freeze ensured the opponent had time to react with anti-air ultra if they had one, so too bad for you if you tried to super fuerte, and instead he lands on you with his invincible ultra 1, which you now can't avoid. It was a mix-up even trying to land it on someone who had no good escapes, since they could either try and time an anti-air on the ground, or even meet you mid-air. Currently, Vega can hit super on the way up, which lets him actually confirm into it. But this isn't a change he got until Ultra, if you can believe that. Vega's reliance on one-bar combos meant super was almost never a factor for him, so it wasn't really a weakness. Most characters rarely use supers in SF4, so Vega having a bad super wasn't really a big deal. But what I'm really getting at is that vanilla Vega's 5EX moves are all extremely situational or outright useless, he has no good FADC, and he has a bad super, so he basically has no useful way of spending bar at all. One of my favorite defective things about Vega is the entire normal of Crouch Fierce. It doesn't cancel, and it's minus 11 on block, minus 6 on hit. Even though you can technically link into it, it's terrible to land because there's no way to make it truly safe. It's safe on airborne opponents because of the air reset, but the only launcher that combos into it is his Cosmic Heal. And that same launcher combos into his Sweep, which does the same damage but also grants a hard knockdown. I bet you're saying to the screen right now, "But Baf, that looks like it might be a really good anti-air." Finally, let's go over some deliberately bad things about Vega which were extra bad in vanilla. If you hit Vega a few times or make him block a few hits, his claw will come off, and eventually his mask too. In vanilla, it took fewer blocked hits for him to lose them, only 14 for the claw. And in vanilla, he'd take significantly more damage if he was hit without his mask compared to later versions. If you want hard numbers, Maskless Vega deals 1.1 times normal damage, but takes 1.25 times damage, so not having the mask is usually horrible. Simple combos would absolutely melt Vega's HP. Additionally, losing the mask and claw was based on number of hits rather than damage, so characters like Gen or Chun-Li could make him lose them incredibly quickly with their safe multi-hit attacks. I mean, hell, just watch this. This is a full durability Vega. When Vega was already the worst character in vanilla, it really makes no sense that he had this special unique mechanic of making him even weaker when he was already losing. You did get that damage buff from not having the mask, but it's small, especially considering it costs 2 bars to remove the mask yourself. Vega can also manually remove his claw, but there was literally no upside to this besides immediately picking it back up to refresh the number of hits you have to take to lose it again. Even up until Ultra, Vega's anti-air is extremely bad. This is a feature rather than a bug, and the idea is that Vega is extremely dominant on the ground compared to most characters, so he should struggle to prevent air approach. In vanilla, you didn't have anti-air Ultra 2 yet, and Crouch Fierce and Storm Roundhouse were even worse than they are now, so basically every attack you had traded or lost to air normals. What this meant was you couldn't really prevent the opponent's approach at all. His main replies were actually meeting the opponent mid-air. But even that often lost to slightly early air buttons from the opponent. Vega also had unusually poor defensive options. His only invincibility came from his backflips, which could admittedly beat some option selects between the variable recovery time.
Hey, it's Tuesday, October the 20th, 2020. This is the Giant Bombcast. I am Brad Shoemaker. Jan Ochoa is here. Jeff Gerstmann is here.
Hi.
Dapper Ben Whoa. Pack is here.
Pew-pew.
Pew-pew.
And very energetic.
He's launched, shooting the guns.
That's
He's
right.
Got,
oh, you got a sugar-free
has,
with you.
Apparently he has wings yes. this week.
I did. The sugar-free wing. Sugar-free.
I got this because I already drank this.
Okay.
Neither of those... Does that one have sugar?
First question, can sugar-free wings really be called wings?
No, they're W-Y-N-G-Z-Z-Z-Z.
Okay, yes.
That's my wings cover band.
They're faux wings. Second question, if Red Bull gives you wings, what does Diet Pepsi give you?
Gout.
Okay, sure.
Yeah. Checks out.
And a prehensile tail.
Mm-hmm.
Man,
I'll get on that.
I would love to have a prehensile tail. That would be so useful.
Would you?
That would be so useful.
You have to cut a hole in all your pants.
That's true. Well, if you could control it that well, you could tuck it into a leg. A pant leg.
Well, what
leg.
If, like, you could start wearing shorts all the time and you just have it peek out under a short leg?
It still comes out, though. It comes out your butt. I mean, well, no matter what you do, it can't go, like...
But it's like top of the crack, right? I mean, it doesn't come out of your butt like it's poo.
Well, sure. You know what I mean, though. It comes out of near your crack.
You would have to change all the types of underwear you wear, too.
It's true. You couldn't
you just wear them low. Because if your tail comes out of the top of the top of your butt crack.
Yeah.
Okay.
You just wear your pants a little bit low.
Mm-hmm.
And it just, you know, like that might be abrasive on one part of the tail. But I think you could do that. Exactly. As Ben is illustrating for people watching the video thing. That's an elephant? Are you making shadow puppets with no shadows? Is this your Jeffrey Toobin?
This is how we get banned.
Save it for the emails.
Toobin zone.
Save it for the emails.
Biff and Jet are banned. Sent home.
They just wanted to go down that river.
Nope.
That's all they wanted
to do. They went down the river Styx, and now what?
And now they're hanging out
World
with
poor or whatever. Yeah.
You do
literally go down the river Styx and Toobin.
I don't know if this is news to anybody, but it's October 20th. We're kind of getting into it here.
In some years we would be in it.
Oh, for sure.
Yet it feels like we are not.
Well,
it's weird.
Let's say pre-new console releases, there's not a lot of it to be in.
Yeah.
There's kind of not anything going on this month. Not even a Call of Duty or something. But
right.
Behind the scenes.
Is there not?
No, it's what is it? November first week of November
13th. Call of Duty.
Nice. After both
Post
consoles.
New consoles.
Wow.
Yes.
Yeah, there's just not much going on in October, but you know things are happening that are ramping up to these releases. I mean, you know, election is 2 weeks from today. Xbox Series X is 3 weeks from today. PlayStation 5 is 2 days after that.
The world is going to be so different because of those three things.
A lot. Of stuff happening in the next
three weeks. If all those things happen and on the other end of it nothing has changed, it's going to be a problem.
Because
those consoles, let me tell you.
Yes?
Let's talk about it.
Okay. What do you got to say?
I'm not excited for new consoles.
No?
There's no games.
Yeah, no, I mean,
I kind of get it.
You, like, if you're a Miles Morales guy, you could just play that on your PlayStation 4.
Yeah.
I actually have been wanting to play Spider-Man again.
I am exceedingly excited about new consoles, but I also agree with you on the games thing. I want to mess around with the new stuff.
Well, that's the thing. Like, you, like me, will be satisfied just dinking around in system menus for a few hours.
And like, seeing like, oh, what? How does this auto HDR stuff go?
Yes.
Like, mm-hmm. what is? How big is that PlayStation 5? What if I stick this controller down my pants? What does it do?
Can I balance that console on my head?
Yes, I want to see a PlayStation.
No,
I want to touch on a PlayStation 5.
I'm gonna go ahead and say you can balance neither of those consoles on your head.
Ooh. Mm. That's Series X.
The Xbox
pretty...
is your best bet.
It's very well balanced.
Dude,
it's pretty big.
It's gonna hurt your head.
It's the top hat of consoles.
It's true. It's true.
Right.
If you just put a
unfortunately,
brim on it, you just put a brim on it. It's like
if you put it on top of the PS4 5, it kind of has that popped collar look. You can kind of, you take the Joy-Cons, you got some arms, you can make a little Voltron there.
Oh man, yeah, it's, but it's a square top hat like it was a Minecraft top hat. It's very on brand.
I want to see fan art where the Series X is the top hat and the PS5 is the popped collar polo shirt.
Oh no.
Somebody, please.
That's like your like cross gen Chan.
That's coexist.
That you want, like, yeah. Yes, yes, it does coexist with the fucking PlayStation logo somehow shaped into an E.
Yeah.
The Series X, I feel like you've just willed like a lot of really bad shit into the world over the last minute here with the things you've been saying out loud. But
I mean, somebody had to get us past all the refrigerator and router photoshops.
Oh yeah, we're post that shit. That's like day one.
Yeah,
yeah,
that was like 5 minutes after the presentations.
I'm also not really into the photoshopping people have been doing to make the PS5 look bigger in that dude's hands and stuff. It's just like when the Xbox One was big, people were photoshopping it, taking up like or like saying like, look at it takes up an entire parking lot or like whatever marketing event that you know, like people thought bigger. They went more places with it than like look it's slightly bigger than
that's
the
funny. I love that. I love a subtle Photoshop just to like kind of throw people off, being like, is that like all the stuff that Vic Berger does with his video editing, where it's just like make him a little more bulbous, make him a little more weird, just to kind of like, and then over time see people get accustomed to it, and then when they release the bigger box, I'm saying it's a psyop. I'm saying it's all a psyop.
Yeah,
psyop
I'm saying
is coming out on the Xbox.
Psyops is coming to
remastered.
Thousands of games, generations. We believe in them, or
give
we don't.
Remedy the psyop IP.
Is psyops confirmed backwards compatible?
I don't believe it is.
I don't think PSYOP is one of the 100 most popular PS4 games.
But on the Xbox, if and when you get
I don't think they have put the, because that is an original Xbox game.
Just put the PSYOP disc in there and see what happens.
Let me check and see. Do I own PSYOP on the Xbox?
How do you not have PSYOP on?
I might only own it on PS2.
I'm going to say there is 0% chance.
Yeah, I'm saying it is. Likely that I own it, but also it is not supported on the backwards compatibility list.
Well, whatever. That's unfortunate.
I do own both versions of PsyOps: The Mindgate Conspiracy, 2004 Zone.
Doesn't that game start with somebody throwing a truck with their mind?
Probably.
I think that's all I know about PsyOps.
Seems like how it would go.
I wanted to ask, where are we going to be at with the online rhetoric now that the PlayStation 5 is the big ass console? Because
it
has been one of the talking points among the Sony Roddy.
Oh boy.
Like, oh, your big American console.
Yeah,
how
like,
boring.
Like yeah, I literally just Googled, you know, the infamous photo of Japanese journalists laughing at the original. Talking points among the people. Are we going to be at with the online rhetoric now that the PlayStation 5 is the big ass console? Because
it
has been one of the talking points among the Sony Roddy.
Oh boy.
Like, oh, your big American console.
Yeah, yeah,
how
like,
boring.
Like yeah, I literally just Googled, you know, the infamous photo of Japanese journalists laughing at the original Xbox.
Yes,
you remember that? Have you guys ever seen that?
Yeah.
The youngsters among us. Have you?
I was in Japan for the original Xbox launch.
Yeah,
and I remember, like, yes, Japanese journalists not necessarily like laughing at it, but definitely looking at it, going, like, "Okay," like they're definitely a like, "Okay, Microsoft, you showed up and did this event. Like, I don't know why, but here you go." Definitely not into it. They were definitely not into it.
Oh, how the tables have turned.
Hummer doesn't play as well in Japan. The Hummer of consoles.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
which was the
but yeah, so that was always the thing, is like, okay, well, now you've got an Xbox that seems to be, you know, based off the specs, is more powerful than the PlayStation 5, but also big in a different way, where the PS5 is big in a big, well, we better, you know, talk about the bulbous anime nightmare of the PlayStation 5 versus the fucking
monolith nightmare.
Gigantic slab of Xbox.
Like, honestly, so. I'm like... I feel like the PS5 is the EVA mech,
and the Xbox Series X is the BattleTech mech.
Yeah,
like, they're both just—they're both just like the Eastern versus Western types of mechs.
What's the other Gundam, like the evil Gundams, the little squat-looking Cyclops ones, Ben? Zekrom something. That's what the Xbox reminds me of.
The little,
little
guy.
Stout. Yeah.
Yeah.
Little the stout, built like a tank.
He doesn't really have limbs. He just kind of has nubs.
Yeah. Zaku. That's Zaku. What it is. Yeah.
All right.
Stuff's happening.
Yeah, I mean,
these consoles are going to come out. Like,
there's Demon Souls. There's the new Spider-Man.
My credit card has been charged for one of the consoles, in fact.
Whoa. Wait.
I have a pending charge from...
Oh, pending. Okay, I thought that I was going to say. I thought they didn't do that until they shipped.
No, you can see, like, what's on hold. And different retailers are going to do it differently. So,
yeah.
But I have a hold on my credit card for $540.
Should I ask which one?
I don't remember. Because they're both the same.
They're both $4.99, so you'd have to look up
two Switch Lights.
Who you got what from?
Which pre-order started? PS5. So this would be the PS5,
okay.
I think.
Then. All right. Okay.
Because I got my Xbox from Best Buy, and this isn't a Best Buy. Okay, yeah. So that is the PlayStation 5, I believe, has a hold charge on it, and it kept sending notifications to my phone. I think as they would like put the hold on and take it off. I don't know what happened. But like over the last week, I've gotten like notifications on my phone for like, hey, this place charged you $540. And I got like three of them. And I'm like, oh, did their system glitch out? And I accidentally bought three fucking PS5s. And I thought for a moment,
Jan, you know, we have very, very different conditions than most people when it comes to like the consoles. We kind of have to be up on both. But since we're not going to be in the office for a while where we'd normally be able to access both pretty easily, are you leaning one way or another? Are you looking at these consoles at all?
I mean, I really want to play Miles Morales, but I can play that on a PS4. The only thing kind of pushing me over the edge, at least in this launch window, is Dark Souls. But also the look of the new Xbox just intrigues me because of how much of a monolith it looks like. Also, I feel like there's a perfect place on my desk right now that's square enough that I think it might fit.
Yeah.
Just get a mini fridge and put that there.
Right, yeah. They're interchangeable.
Yeah, a good mini fridge about the same price as like an Xbox Series S. So I don't know.
You really, it's weird though. You really are in a situation where even you guys needing to play games for like a Game of the Year feature or whatever, like there's next to no games you aren't gonna be able to play in some form with the hardware that you already have.
Right, and like Ben and I both have like PCs now.
Right,
so
right.
That also,
I think like Demon's Souls is like it, right? Like, isn't that basically about, like you know, the one game that you can't?
Destruction All Stars is that maybe not?
Right. Yes. Oh no, what? I think that got pushed, didn't it?
Just making up games again.
Because even Bugsnax is coming out on PC, right?
Yeah, Bugsnax is coming to PC same day.
An Astrobot. That's
Astrobot. Yes.
Sackboys.
Astrobot's not real.
Sack
Astrobot can't hurt you.
Does Astrobot get a page in the wiki since it's a packet? Like it's not a retail.
Oh wait,
it's a retail
game. Is the new Five Nights at Freddy's only PS5?
Oh, that can't be right. There's no way.
There's no way. It's coming to, for the first time, a console, the PS, PlayStation.
Okay, I guess not. I could have sworn Destruction All Stars.
The PS PlayStation
got delayed, but it looks like no.
PlayStation.
The PSP is back.
Yep, PSP's
okay,
back.
Okay.
Hell yeah, baby.
And it's huge.
The PSNP. The PlayStation, no way portable.
Yeah, I mean, they knew people couldn't travel anymore, so they were just like, you don't need to take it with you.
Yeah.
It's actually, if you sit in it, it's
in it.
Made in a way that if they're stacked together, you're keeping 6 feet away from anyone else who's also sitting in one. It's perfect.
Get in the PSP, Ben.
Yeah, just fucking, you have to like G Gundam it and put on the suit that's like liquid metal over you, and you just have to break through, and then you can kind of control Kratos to do his whips with your arms. It's pretty cool. I'm excited for that more than the PS5.
Yes, I love to do Kratos's whips.
The other thing is like, I don't know if we'd be able to take advantage of like the streaming at like 120 or like whatever hertz in like 4K given like our current setups at home.
Yeah, we were talking about that yesterday. Like, I don't think there's a place for us to host 120 hertz video, is there?
Yeah, unless we just drop like
like our player right now, I think would probably bust it down to 60 if I had to guess.
Yeah.
And
I mean, we could literally do what I did with that Minecraft server and just host it as a file that people can download from our servers.
Right. Yeah. That's, yes. I'm sure that there's some backwater server somewhere we could throw that on that no one would notice, and it'd be like cbsallaccess.com/brad/private/space.dot/shifted space
boletaria underscore
zero day slash
tower homework. Underscore of tower underscore latria dot mkv. Yes, consoles.
Yeah, man, it's gonna be ridiculous. I think that aspect of it is gonna be really weird, and I don't know what to do about the 120 hertz stuff. Like, I'm curious to see it. I guess I'll try plugging it into this monitor here because that's a high refresh rate thing, and hopefully that'll work. But yes, the hosting and distribution of video that is even recorded that way doesn't seem like something that we'll see a lot of at or around launch. I mean, shit, man, like Microsoft and Sony doing their streams and press conferences and all the other stuff. We're like, hey, we put this out at 1080 60 because it's hard. So like even they weren't necessarily ready to go with that stuff when they did their announcements. So whatever.
Yeah.
We'll figure it out.
We'll say, hey.
And then the video robot end of it, I mean, honestly, like, hey. We are in the middle of a big acquisition, and the technology and all that other stuff is not in a place where I think we could go. I mean, whatever. I have a meeting tomorrow. I'll ask. But the idea of going in and saying, like, hey, can you update all this stuff that to support 120 hertz? Doesn't seem like something that we would do near term.
Video encoding platform that we're not sure we're going to have access to in a few months.
That honestly sounds great because I think switching to a different, better video platform would be cool. Getting off of the thing that we use to distribute our videos to YouTube, which is bad, and replacing it with something that was good would be fucking radical.
I like technology that is good. Personally,
I love technology when it's good, and I think getting away from some bad technology and replacing it with better technology sounds exciting. That's why I'm excited about the consoles. Regardless of if there are new games out for them, I am like actually still like I'm pretty psyched to get those things in and get my filthy hands all over them and fuck around with some games and see what works, what doesn't.
I'm excited. Which of the two do you think is going to have a better smell out of the box?
Xbox.
Too
many components at play on the outside of the PS5. Each of those is going to have a different finish, and I think they're going to fight with each other.
Because the Xbox, it's like matte around it, right? The PS5 seems like.
Xbox is just.
Light be with you. Safe travels.
What's on your mind? What's your back?
What brings you here?
It's like, you know, one big kind of not scented candle versus a couple of scented candles, small, but the scents just don't match, you know. It's not gonna work.
I think the PS5 will have that chemically smell that I need.
Okay, sure.
Oh, so I hate that. I hate that chemically smell.
How much plastic do you think you'll be able to like peel off of the new consoles? I feel like the PS5 is gonna have a lot of it. The Xbox is just gonna be wrapped in plastic.
Yeah.
You think?
I think so. It's gonna be wrapped in plastic.
One X just had that one little sticker on the front.
So the Xbox will be wrapped in plastic. PS5, we'll have a fishnets percolator. We'll get past all this stuff, and then it'll all
PS5
work out.
PS5 will come in a large Crown Royal bag.
Okay. Okay. Sure. That's good.
All right.
You know what?
Crown Royal bag.
I'd be down.
What if it was a water-cooled console, but it just had a spout at the top you could open and then just drink Crown Royal out of it? And then, but if you don't replace the Crown Royal and turn on the PS5, it's going to overheat. Like, don't fucking do it.
Oh, no. And as we all know, Crown Royal ages very well.
It starts good, gets better. That's the promise.
Yes. Indeed.
I had a roommate who got way into Crown Royal, and I have like a zillion of those little bags, felt bags. They're great bags.
Dude, they're so
you got 25 dice.
They're so versatile.
Hey. Yeah.
You can put anything in there.
Yeah. Almost. Cool rock.
Yeah. That's right.
Cool rocks.
Anything.
That's right.
I got cool rocks. You want to see some rocks?
See
some.
I like cool rocks.
Jeff has left to get his cool rocks.
I like cool rocks.
That was
better
too close to you. That was way too close to you.
Wow,
it's big.
That's a smooth rock.
It's smooth. Not watching the. It's a circular. It's gray.
That's a real. That's a real skipper.
Yeah. Oh yeah. It's a little. Yeah. I found it. They said take only pictures, leave only footprints, and I said yeah, but what if I took a rock too? And so I did, and now I got this rock that I got from a beach. I don't remember which one.
You guys good at skipping rocks? I'm terrible at it.
I used to be great at it. I used to be really
good
at it.
Yeah. Okay.
But I haven't done
it
in a long time.
It's one of those things, if you don't use it, you lose it.
Oh, no.
It's one of those. Yeah.
Shit.
Long lost art.
Yeah.
Speaking of long lost arts, the art of driving remote controlled vehicles around your house.
Oh, I have thought about using this as a webcam today.
He brought a prop.
I brought a prop. Mario Kart Live. Home circuit now out in stores. I gotta say, y'all, this thing is pretty dang neat. Quick look is up on the site now.
Yeah, can you hold it up?
Yeah,
that's pretty,
I
pretty
it was
sizable.
Be, it's
yeah,
like it's a two hander for Jan.
So, hold on, where's something? Okay,
I thought it'd be like, you know, a little guy like this.
Oh, really? No, right. I think that's about exactly the size.
Whoa! You should.
See,
so here's a switch.
During the break, you should absolutely set that up as a webcam.
Oh,
for the rest of the show.
I have a ruler. I think I mentioned in the quick look, it's like 5x7, and then it's like about 3.5 inches tall. And it's Nintendo's latest foray into the AR physical toy sphere. And so instead of like playing on pre-made tracks, like in Mario Kart, like Rainbow Road, et cetera, you are physically making the tracks. They give you four different gates, cardboard gates to drive underneath, and you make your own custom course from there. And they recommend that you have a space of 10x12 feet. It's kind of pretty big, especially if you live in like a small apartment, a one bedroom type of deal. I had to clear a lot of space, even my kitchen. It seemed like I didn't have enough space there. I made too tight of a loop donut that the camera on this bad boy wasn't able to read the gate numbers or whatever. It's $99, only one per cart.
Yeah, that's kind of steep.
And it's kind of steep. Switch. So if you're playing two player, you need two switches on top of that.
Well,
so
for the price, I mean, you'd kind of expect people would bring their own switch and thing over that they bought anyway. But
I ain't bringing nothing nowhere.
Yeah,
right?
I know.
Fair.
You'd be able to use two Joy-Cons and play like on a Switch together.
I mean, that's my real question, is this thing worth it if you're the only one that has one?
So if you're the only one that has one,
it's a lot of time trials, right?
It's a lot of time trials, but you do race against like AI Koopalings and Bowser Jr. On like the courses you make.
That's okay.
And I was a little hesitant hesitant because, like, you know, once you make the one course and you're stuck doing a Grand Prix, how is that gonna get differentiated per each different course or whatever. But then with the AR, it just winds up kind of adding environmental hazards, changing up the aesthetics or like the look of the courses. And look, like in the quick look, the first race we did, it was just a plain race through my living room. But then the second one, it was supposed to be underwater, so everything was underwater. I couldn't tell if the physics itself felt like how the underwater segments in Mario Kart races go. But the environmental hazards were some that you'd come across in an underwater level. Like the gates were covered in coral and stuff. And like that part's really neat. Yeah.
Does it, when you're saying like it looks like the Mario Kart stuff, does it actually play like the Mario Kart stuff? Is it kind of a one-to-one?
So that's the weird thing. Like you can, it plays exactly like how Mario Kart would. You can drift.
Yeah, that was the, when I watched your quick look, that was the thing that really stuck out to me. It was like, oh my God, they do the straight up sparks when you're drifting that change color the more you drift. But I mean, does that thing, surely that thing doesn't physically drift, right?
It's not physically drifting. Okay. Like in, when you're watching the camera feed, it looks like how it would in the normal Mario Kart games. But then I was watching the physical kart and it's just like, you know, kind of slowly turning, and it's not like drifting on your actual floor or anything.
Does it get the little boost after?
It does get the little boost. Okay. So in a right out the box, you have access to 50 and 100 CC. The more you keep playing and earning trophies, you get access to 150 and 200. Mm-hmm. And you know, some of the Mario Kart power-ups, like the Bullet Bill power-up, will make you zoom by faster. And it actually